of thing. So I have to paste one more thing into my screen. So, just give me a second here. I'll try to occupy the sound until I have a DVD some friends of ours did at Ingenuity Films. It's called The Coming Convergence, and I would highly recommend that you get this. You can go to thecomingconvergence.com, and it's interesting they came up with this title, even, you know, independent of what I've been saying all along with the fact that everything is converging. And I would highly recommend that you get this. I'm looking for a, oh, there it is. Okay. I apologize for this. I get up about 2 o'clock, 2 or 3 o'clock on Sunday mornings to get everything done because I do have a job. And I've been very, very busy the last couple of weeks. So I try to get things done early. So anyway, comingconvergence.com, you can buy this. I highly recommend it. It's very well done. They did a video a few years back called The Final Prophecies, which was also excellent. Brent Miller Jr., Brent Miller Sr., and then Brent Miller Jr.'s wife, Carrie Miller. Great people. I had a chance to meet with them for a few hours when I was in California in January. And this was still in the final process, so it's out now. I'd highly recommend that you get a copy of it. It comes in Blu-ray, too, if you actually have one of those. So I don't get, by the way, I get no cut from that. So, okay, so I apologize for the being behind. Here's today's update. We're going to call it the Super Mighty Update. Now let me explain something. Last week I titled my thing, Mother of All Updates, and this week is the Super Mighty Update. I don't want anyone to get the impression that I actually think it's the Mother of All Updates or a Super Mighty Update, okay? I put a title up just because to distinguish it from other people that are doing prophecy updates that do very good jobs, but there's, you know, a bunch of things out there called prophecy update. And so I don't do this because I have some massive ego that I think I'm the best in the world at it or anything like that. This is tongue-in-cheek, and it's built off of what happened in the news this week. So please don't comment on the YouTube channel about, well, I don't think it was all that great, you know, or you certainly didn't live up to the Super Mighty Update title. It's kind of a joke, okay? I have a sense of humor. You know, I'm not... you may not believe this, I'm not particularly arrogant and that type of thing, but I'm usually right, but I'm not arrogant. I'm very humble about being right all the time. So we talk each week about the, and you'll see later in the update why I called it the Super Mighty Update. Could somebody get me a bottle of water too, by the way? I forgot to get one on the way in here. And I see my director's not in the room right now, so. Just one, unused preferably, and so we talk each week about the convergence of events, and each week it seems, you know, I'm more and more amazed. At first, sometimes when I sit down, I was a little bit late this week, sitting down and kind of going through everything to kind of coalesce it into some kind of presentable fashion, and I thought, well, you know, not that much really happened this week that I would think prophetically significant. And I also want you to know, I don't always put up all the Bible verses and everything that might relate to what I'm talking about. And part of that is a lot of people in church here, we've been together for years, we kind of know some of these verses. Some of the important ones that I talk about are 2 Timothy 3 and 4, about what's going to happen in the last days, and the apostasia, the departure from the faith that we'll see in the last days, growing unbelief, people giving themselves over to myths rather than the truth. Also, Matthew 24, 25, Luke chapter 21, Luke chapter 17, Ezekiel 38 and 39, Ezekiel 36, 35 and 36. So those are some of the key passages, and I apologize, I just don't sometimes have the time to put it all into a neat little package. Hopefully this summer I'll be doing some conferences in different places, and I'll have some more time for that, but it is a crazy world, so let's just look at some things. Now, one thing I don't look at too often is economic news, and we know that there will be economic turmoil in the end times. There's going to be things that happen, and really, when you look at things, at least what's predicted in Revelation and that type of thing, eventually there'll be a total economic collapse, there'll be famine and that sort of thing. And I think those happen within the 70th week, but I think you're going to see the stage set for that. Like, for example, right now in famine, there are 20 million people in Africa alone that are at great risk of starving to death in the very near term. In Ethiopia, Somalia, Nigeria, they're having a massive drought, massive famine, and people are dying. And it's when you look at what's going on in the world from a famine standpoint and from a refugee standpoint, we are way past the numbers that we saw at the end of World War II. These are problems that are almost unprecedented of this scale worldwide in human history. And I think it's indicative of the end times. Now, one of these things is store closings. This is related to America. I don't know if this is going on in Europe. I happen to be involved in a big bankruptcy, and these store closings are happening all over the place. Look at this article from the Wall Street Journal. American retailers are closing stores at a record pace this year as they feel the fallout from decades of overbuilding and the rise of online shopping. There's no reason to believe that this will abate at any point in the foreseeable future, said Mark Cohen, the director of retail studies for Columbia Business School and a former executive at Sears Canada Inc. and other department stores. Based on the pace so far, the brokerage estimates retailers will close more than 8,600 locations this year, which would eclipse the number of closings during the 2008 recession. At least 10 retailers, including apparel seller, Limited Stores, Inc., electronics chain, H.H. Gregg, and sporting goods chain, Gander Mountain, have filed for bankruptcy protection so far this year. That compares with 9 retailers that declared bankruptcy with at least $50 million in liabilities for all of 2016. And here's a chart that kind of indicates where they're going. The Wall Street Journal chart is inaccurate in that the H.H. Gregg closing here, the second one from the right, they say they're closing 88 of 220 stores, actually closing all 220 because they couldn't find a buyer. They just couldn't find a buyer. So that's an economic thing. Another economic thing, which may be good for the famine, I don't know, maybe not, that America no longer is necessarily the breadbasket for the world. There are other countries that have now passed us in certain areas. If you look at this chart, the top one there, in 1985, the United States produced 77% of all soybeans exports. Now we're down to 38%, and in fact, we've been passed by Brazil. Will have more soybean exports this year than we will. And so I think it's Russia, I think it's close to us in production, or maybe passing us in production of wheat. And of course, you see the corn percentage has fallen from 56% to 37%. With the result that because there's more people producing it, guess what happens? Even though there are a bunch of socialist governments in the world, they don't understand basic economics. And so as more people, more countries produce more food, what happens to the price of food? It drops. What does that mean? Farmers make less money. Farmers can't afford the payments they have on their equipment. More farmers go bankrupt. Price of farmland would fall as a result. So it makes for a very volatile market in what's heretofore been a fairly stable, though heavily subsidized by our government, part of our economy. There was also this thing in Washington this week, Earth Day 2017. I actually remember the first Earth Day. I was a sophomore in high school, and so what I did was a bunch of my buddies got together and we decided that we would drive the most, the worst gas-guzzling car we could to school that day while everybody else was walking. The parking lot was wide open and we got to park closer to the building, and we felt very smug and self-righteous and smarter than everybody else. But this thing, I didn't have time. Maybe I'll play it next week. Bill Nye, the science guy, is, we believe in science. I mean, it's like a religious evangelistic, a religious crusade that he's conducting there when he's speaking on the mall in Washington yesterday about how great science is. We believe in science, and science will be the cure for everything, and science will save us. And I'm telling you, this is, I think, indicative of that one world religion that we talk about all the time. Now, I started to do something, and this will show you that I just ran out of time. I was going to make up these nifty little monitors and have them blow up as I went to each topic and everything. So pretend like when I go to each topic that I actually finished this, because I didn't. I just didn't have time. And maybe next week I'll finish the one that I did for this week and I'll be behind on the one for next week. But are you having trouble?
Your mic's all the way back here.
I didn't. Oh, okay. Do I have to start over? Oh, it sounded like it was in a tunnel. I was, the tunnel of converging prophetic events. So we'll talk a little bit this week. We already talked about store closings. We'll look a little bit at something in Sweden. We'll look at Lakewood Church. We'll look at a response to Lakewood Church. We'll look at something with Mahmoud Barghouti, who's a terrorist. And then we'll look at a little bit about Erdogan. And I don't think I'm going to, it's a beautiful slide, a beautiful monitor thing there, but I don't think I'll get to that thing in Syria, because I just don't think I'll have time. So, Lakewood Church. Now, some people say Lakewood Church is the biggest church in America. They draw around 45,000 to 48,000 people every Sunday in Houston. And the couple services that they have, Joel Osteen, their pastor's written books. I've heard he's made over $40 million from writing books. Which I don't mind if somebody makes money writing books. I'm bothered by somebody who makes a lot of money writing fluff, which I think his books are, and they're not really theologically based. It's his opinion. I think it's very Laodicean, and that's what Laodicea means, is people's opinions. Everybody's got an opinion about everything. But last Sunday, Joel gave the pulpit over to his wife, Victoria, for a moment, and she talked about the resurrection story. Why? Because it was Resurrection Sunday, right? And so she actually opened the Bible, and she went to the passage, and then she gave her opinion. I want to listen to a little bit. So she talks about all the people. They went to the tomb, and they saw that the stone was rolled away, and then she kind of comes into a conclusion and makes an application. And I just want you to listen to this, about a 2-minute clip, and listen to what she has to say.
And when they got to the tomb, the Bible says that they looked up, and they were so surprised. The stone had been rolled away. The stone was not blocking the tomb anymore. The obstacle that was trying to defeat them had been rolled away. Think about that just a minute. What they were worried about, what was there, is now gone. Mary walked into the tomb and saw the angel, and the angel declared to her, "Are you looking for Jesus? He's not here. He's risen. He's risen."
Shift is coming. It's great.
You see, the problem that she was facing that day was met with a promise. The promise of the resurrection. As soon as the angel told her, "He's not here, he's risen," the Bible says that she was reminded of the promises of Jesus. He said, "I'll rise again." He said, "The temple will be built back in 3 days." See, when she heard it, she remembered the promise. Sometimes when you're walking through a difficult situation and there's obstacles in your path, it's hard to remember those resurrection promises. But can I tell you today Stones are meant to stop you. Sometimes there are stones in reality that you cannot move on your own. They are impossible. They're out of your control. But can I tell you today that Jesus is alive and he's still rolling away the stones? He's still moving stones in your life. It was Easter Sunday, and Mary didn't even know it. I hope this is Easter Sunday makes you take a look at those blocks in your life, those stones, those things that are trying to weigh you down, cause fear and anxiety, those things that would like to stop you from fulfilling your destiny. I hope you look at those stones differently. And next time you run into one of those things, I hope you look at it and you say, he has risen, and I will stand on the resurrection promises of the Lord Jesus Christ.
And so the stones are... Do you see the shift that she made there? The stones are things that prevent you from achieving your destiny. And that's just not what the story is about. That's not the point. That's not the theology that we should take away from that. And so you see how, I mean, some of what she said was actually correct. It was true. But then she shifted it and got it going. Her stone rolled down the wrong hill, I guess is the way that it was. And this is the problem with that church. I mean, I listen to it every now and then just to see how they're doing. And sometimes it's okay, but then they're like, right in the middle of it, they do this huge shift to this kind of crazy word faith stuff that they teach. And it's very problematic. Very problematic. Down in Australia this week, last week was the Presence Conference at C3 Church. It's sort of a Hillsong type church. Phil Pringle is the pastor there. And they have this huge conference. They rent the Sydney Convention Center. And here's their promo for next year. There's no sound on this. Next year for the 2018, you know, it's called Free, I think is what they're calling it. Free 2018. And you can get there for $189. Now, the reason that I bring that up is there's a clip out there. I don't have time to play the clip of Stephen Furtick, but he spoke this year, and he got up to do the offering one night, and he just beat the people over the head with about how they needed. They gave $189 to come to the conference, and he's talking like, man, if you think that, you know, that covers the cost of this conference and my fee for flying me and my wife here from North Carolina to Sydney, you don't understand basic math, which is very condescending. Babylon Bee had a thing this week. That's a satire site, by the way, BabylonBee.com. And they put up satire, and one of their satire articles was Stephen Furtick preached a long message about why his message was so good or something like that. And but he's not... He always twists it to be about him. And I find him to be one of the more troubling pastors out there. I think he's misleading people. There was a great sermon, though, preached once by a Stephen. Let me read you just a little bit of that in Acts chapter 7 before the Sanhedrin. Then said the high priest, are these things so? And Stephen said, men, brethren, and fathers, hearken. The God of glory appeared unto our father Abraham when he was in Mesopotamia before he dwelt in Haran, and said unto him, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred, and come into the land which I shall show thee. Then he came out of the land of the Chaldeans and dwelt in Haran, and from thence, when his father was dead, he removed him into this land wherein ye now dwell. And he gave him no inheritance in it, no, not so much as set his foot upon, yet he promised that he would give it to him for possession and to his seed after him when he as yet had no child. And God spake on this wise that his seed should sojourn in a strange land, that they should bring in them into bondage and entreat them evil 400 years. And the nation to whom they shall be in bondage will I judge, said God. And after that they shall come forth and serve me in this place. And he gave him the covenant of circumcision. So Abraham began Isaac and circumcised him the eighth day, and Isaac began Jacob. Begat Jacob, and Jacob begat the 12 patriarchs. And the patriarchs moved with envy, sold Joseph into Egypt, but God was with him. And he delivered him out of all of his afflictions and gave him favor and wisdom in the sight of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. And he made him governor over Egypt and his house. Now there came a dearth over the land of Egypt and Canaan in great affliction, and our fathers found no sustenance. But when Jacob heard that there was corn in Egypt, he sent out our fathers first. And at the second time, Joseph was made known to his brethren, and Joseph's kindred was made known unto Pharaoh. Then sent him Joseph and called his father Jacob to him, and all his kindred, 75 souls. So Jacob went down into Egypt and died, he and our fathers, and were carried over into Shechem and laid in the sepulcher that Abraham brought there for a sum of money unto the sons of Emor, the father of Sychem. And when the time of the promise drew nigh, which God had sworn to Abraham, this is preaching, by the way. Okay, Stephen was a deacon in the early church. And it'd be great if every deacon could get up and preach like this. Because you see what he's doing contrasted to the other two people I just mentioned? He's sticking with the plot line. He's sticking with the story. He's being accurate. But when the time of the promise drew nigh, verse 17, which God had sworn to Abraham, the people grew and multiplied in Egypt, till another king arose, which knew not Joseph. And then he goes on to talk a little bit about Moses and his early life and how Moses killed a man. Verse 29, then fled Moses at this saying and was a stranger in the land of Midian, where he begat 2 sons. And when 40 years were expired, there appeared to him in the wilderness of Mount Sinai an angel of the Lord in a flame of fire in a bush. When Moses saw it, he wondered at the sight, and as he drew near to behold it, the voice of the Lord came unto him, saying, I am the God of thy fathers, the God of Abraham, and the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. Then Moses trembled and durst not behold. I have seen the affliction of my people which is in Egypt, and I have heard their groaning, and am come down to deliver them. And now come, I will send thee into Egypt. You see, what's going to happen, particularly with the Jewish people, but I think to some extent the church, Jesus, we know from Hosea chapter 5, in the early part of Hosea chapter 5:15, and then into the early part of chapter 6 of Hosea, that Jesus returns in response, the second coming comes about as a response by Jesus to the pleas of the Jewish people to be rescued. They're calling out for their Messiah to come rescue them physically. And he returns in response to that plea. Very similar to what happened in Egypt. Verse 36, he brought them out after he had showed signs and wonders in the land of Egypt and in the Red Sea and in the wilderness 40 years. This is that Moses was said unto the children of Israel, a prophet shall the Lord your God raise up unto you of your brethren, like unto me, and him shall ye hear. This is he that was in the church in the wilderness with the angel which spake to him in Mount Sinai, and with our fathers who received the lively oracles to give unto us, to whom the fathers would not obey, but thrust him from them, and in their hearts turned back again towards Egypt. You know, the old saying, God got them out of Egypt, but he didn't get Egypt out of them. Verse 40, saying unto Aaron, make us gods before us, and as this Moses, which brought us out of the land of Egypt, we wot not what is become of him. And they made a calf in those days, and offered sacrifice unto the idol, and rejoiced in the works of their own hands. And we know that that golden calf didn't just appear that one time in the desert. Remember, Rehoboam, the first king of the northern tribe. No, Jeroboam, the first king of the northern kingdom of Israel. After Solomon's death, the kingdom split into two. And what did he do right away? He set up a golden calf, one in Dan and one in Bethel, so people could worship. He set one in Bethel and one in Dan because he didn't want, you know, he was like the first seeker-sensitive guy. You know, he was like Robert Schuller of his day, who had the drive-in church. You know, we don't want them to have to go all the way to Jerusalem. It's too much trouble, so we'll put one here in Dan, and we'll put one in Bethel, so they don't have to travel that far. And I'll be very popular because of that. It's very similar to what people in the church do today. It repeats itself. Then God turned and gave them up to worship the host of heaven. As it is written in the book of the prophets, O ye house of Israel, have ye offered to me slain beasts and sacrifices by the space of 40 years in the wilderness? Yea, ye took up the tabernacle of Moses and the star of your God, Rephaim, figures which ye made to worship them, and I will carry you away beyond Babylon. Our fathers had the tabernacle of witness in the wilderness, as he had appointed, speaking unto Moses, that he should make it according to the fashion that he had seen. Which also our fathers that came up after him brought in with Joshua into the possession of the Gentiles, whom God drove out before the face of our fathers unto the days of David, who found favor before God and desired to find a tabernacle for the God of Jacob. But Solomon built him a house. And he was standing there in the area where Solomon had built that original temple, which was destroyed by Babylon, but then rebuilt by Zerubbabel and then modified and expanded greatly by Herod. In verse 48, he says, Howbeit the Most High dwelleth not in temples made with hands, as saith the prophet, Heaven is my throne and earth is my footstool. What house will you build me, saith the Lord? Or what is the place of my rest? Hath not my hand made all these things? He's stiff-necked, and then and now he's, you can see that Stephen, he's not a seeker-sensitive guy. Okay? And I know people don't like it when you yell and you scream and you point out names and that type of thing, but in large part it's the pattern of the early apostles. And this deacon, Stephen, who's preaching this fantastic sermon in the front of the Sanhedrin. Ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, ye always do resist the Holy Ghost, as your fathers did, so do ye. Which of the prophets have you not your fathers persecuted? And they have slain them, which showed before of the coming of the Just One, of whom ye have been now the betrayers and murderers, who have received the law by the disposition of angels and have not kept it. And when they heard these things, they were cut to the heart, and they gnashed on him with their teeth. But he, being full of the Holy Ghost, looked up steadfastly to heaven and saw the glory of God, and Jesus standing on the right hand of God, and said, Behold, I see the heavens open, and the Son of Man standing on the right hand of God. Why? Because his work was over, it was finished for all time. Everybody now that gets saved from the time of Jesus' death is saved the same way. Then they cried out with a loud voice and stopped their ears and ran upon him with one accord and cast him out of the city and stoned him. And the witness laid down their clothes at a young man's feet whose name was Saul. And they stoned Stephen, calling upon God and saying, Lord Jesus, and they stoned Stephen, and he was calling upon God and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And he kneeled down and cried with a loud voice, Lord, lay not this sin to their charge. And when he had said of this, he fell asleep. So that was an early deacon in the church preaching. And they killed him for it. He was martyred because he spoke the truth. Didn't water it down. He didn't try to make it palatable. He didn't try to make some crazy application of what was said. He was direct. He was to the point. He spoke the truth. He told the story that needed to be told. And that's why I talk about some of these preachers, because I think they're massively deceiving people as to the true nature of the gospel and what God's work is in their lives and how God has worked in the past and will work in the future through a period of time that we believe is coming very soon called the 70th week of Daniel. So that is a good message. Okay, now let's go back to the prophecy update. We had the March for Science yesterday. I mentioned that a little bit earlier. National Review. And by the way, just so you know, if I use a news source here, that should never be interpreted that I endorse everything that that news source says. If you think that that's what I'm doing, you are dead wrong. I use them to prove a point. So you will find a mixed bag in sources that I use. For example, I use Fox News sometimes. I don't agree with everything that Fox News. I don't watch that much of it. I find some clips that I find. I have one that today that I think is very interesting. I think it presents a good perspective. And you'll see it in a few minutes. But I don't endorse everything that Fox News does. Okay? I didn't like Bill O'Reilly, by the way. I just didn't like him. Okay, I just didn't care for them. But there are people that I like and people that I watch, but sometimes they interview people that there's a point to prove about, like, the craziness of this religion that we call leftism. It's pointed out there sometimes, but sometimes I'll use MSNBC or NBC or CBS, you know, so, but that doesn't mean I endorse everything that they say. But National Review, and it's a mixed bag too, but they've got a great article this week by Orrin Cass about who's a denier now. Climate apocalypticism ignores the science. And what's interesting about what's going on in the area of climate change is that people, you know, they would look at what we talk about here and, oh, he's just this crazy end times apocalyptic guy or church. But they have their own eschatology. You understand that. The world's going to end. It's all, and their explanation is that man has caused everything. And they're going to stick to that even when God intervenes directly and causes these unbelievable signs that happen within the 70th week, maybe some before. Things will happen, and true believers will see it, and they'll say, that's God. And these people will, to the end, a lot of them, unfortunately, will be saying, it's all caused by man. We have an explanation. If we were just better, everything would be okay. We don't need, there is no God. We're God. That's really what they're saying. I mean, and look at the sign that somebody was carrying at this. Not even Hitler doubted climate change. So it's okay for people on the left to throw out the Hitler card. But if somebody on the right plays the Hitler card, then, you know, everybody has the equivalent of a nervous breakdown. Now, in England, there is a teachers' union. And what the teachers' union is promoting, early education about transgenderism and LGBTQ issues. And they have an agenda. They're having a conference. I don't know if it was this week or last week. Saturday the 29th to Sunday the 30th, LGBT plus Teachers Conference 2017, Equality Rocks, Moving Forward and Looking Back. And the name of the organization is the National Union of Teachers. And I have to say that the anacronym that comes from their name is probably one of the most accurate anacronyms in the history of humankind. In fact, if you look down through this program, you see Anita Price. She is the Nut Executive ESH, National Executive LGBTQ seat holder. And then Kevin Courtney, he is the Nut General Secretary. And then down here at 3:45 on next Saturday in England, they will have this program. It says LGBT Voices in the Nut. Panel of activists sharing their local success stories. You know, sometimes real life is way funnier than anybody could make up. If you made that up and I put that up there, what would be the charge? Fake news, fake, you're lying. Not lying. I'm copying it right off their website. You can go download the Word document of the program. So if you want to go to the Nut conference next week, watch out for if you're going to the Nut conference, watch out for the elephant in the room. Because you remember that Mary Tyler Moore show where the clown got, he was dressed as Mr. Peanut and the elephant. Very funny. Look it up if you never saw it. One of the funniest TV shows of all time. Well, here in the United States, we have these sanctuary cities. Jeff Sessions came out, Attorney General, and said, we're going to take your money away. You don't follow federal law. You go against federal law. We're taking your money away. So now the response has been a bunch of lawsuits filed by these sanctuary cities. And then other editorials like, well, it's not that much money anyway. Well, if it's not that much money anyway, then give it up. And go do your stupid left-wing ideas and go against federal law. And what they're doing is, what happens is there's a thing called, you ask for a detainer. You ask for, if they have an illegal immigrant in custody that's subject to deportation, the federal government can make a detainer request. Usually they are informed by the local county or city or state that is holding the person in jail or prison, And we have a guy that you might want to be interested in. And what these sanctuary cities are doing is, we're not going to do this anymore. We're just going to let the guy go. And there are a number of situations already where these guys have been released from jail or prison because the federal government, I mean, it takes, give them 48 hours or so to get there, but they're releasing these people before that usual standard detainer time, and the guys have gone out and killed people. I'm not making that up. It's happened. It happened in Connecticut. Within like a day after the governor of Connecticut getting up and saying, hey, we're going to be a sanctuary state. The blood of those people that killed us on that guy's head, and he should be held accountable. Because if he had done the right thing, people would not be dead. It's very, very simple. Here's what this letter came out. California officials, we had, this is, by the way, this man in the caricature here is the new Attorney General of California. California officials reacted with defiance Friday, promising to double efforts to guard the state's policies in the face of the implied threat to cut the funds. It's become abundantly clear that Attorney General Jeff Sessions and the Trump administration are basing their law, this is what the Attorney General said, are basing their law enforcement policies on principles of white supremacy, American values, State Senate Leader Kevin DeLeon said in a statement. Their constant and systematic targeting of diverse cities and states goes beyond constitutional norms and will be challenged at every level, he added. California Attorney General Xavier Becerra said that the state would defend its policies against fear-mongering by the Trump administration. They're calling, this is again what the left does, and somebody made a comment last week, I don't know where it was, on Facebook or something. You seem to focus on the left all the time, like, you know, there's bad people on both sides. Yeah, I know, but the left ideas will kill you, okay? You know, as Dennis Prager says, there's the stupid party and the dangerous party. I belong to the stupid party, and I hope to educate them, but the dangerous party, when they get in power, bad things happen. Even when they're out of power, they're scofflaws. They don't care what the law says. They have no intention of going along or cooperating with any of this. Federal threats to take away resources from law enforcement or our people in an attempt to bully states and localities into carrying out the new administration's unsound deportation plan are reckless and jeopardize public safety, he said in a statement. Now listen, this is what, I'm sorry, I don't have an example on the right. Email them to me. I know there's people on the right do stupid stuff all the time. This is dangerous. That's why I bring it up. This is wrong, and what they do all the time is they project. Okay, so they're saying that these deportation policies are reckless and gender safely. Their policies are reckless and endanger safety, and they're projecting it on somebody else. They do this all the time. So keep that in mind. And I'm going to kind of roll through these things pretty quickly. In the Atlantic, David Froome, a man of the left, has an article about the plan to end Europe. And you see Europe there kind of all broken up, and that's Donald Trump, the outline of Donald Trump. You can tell by the hair, I guess. Why Trump is wrong to try to break up the EU or NATO or anything like that. Now, I don't know that Trump needs to do anything because I think the EU and NATO are falling apart on their own. Maybe he's just giving them a little push in that direction. I don't know. And then in Time magazine this week, they have their top 100 leaders or most influential people in the world. One of them is Donald Trump. A lot of them are people you've never heard of. You can find the magazine online in the article. But two of them are Jared Kushner, the son-in-law of the president, and the president's daughter, Ivanka Trump. Now, there's a lot of theories running around out there. I'm sure you've seen them about Jared Kushner, and he owns a building called 666 Fifth Avenue. Well, he doesn't own it personally, but a company that he's involved in owns at least part of it, and this proves that he's the Antichrist and all this. Look, I'm not, at this point, anybody on the world stage that's active in politics and global government leadership is kind of a candidate in my view. We'll see how it plays out, though, okay? I don't think we're to the point where anybody should be running around saying, this is the person. That's just my opinion, And I know I have friends who will judge me for having that opinion. But I will point out, I am concerned about Kushner from the standpoint, not so much his Antichrist thing, but influences in his life. Because the person who wrote his bio for this top 100 thing, if you can see it right down here, Jared Kushner, the trusted advisor by Henry Kissinger. Now, there's no doubt about the bad quality of a Henry Kissinger. That is beyond. And when you read about it, Kissinger was glad to do it because he has mentored Jared as he was growing up. So I am concerned about that and that influence, okay? And whether you like that or not, I don't think Kissinger is a good guy. And he's still plugging along. He sits in a chair now. He barely gets his head above the back. He seems to be getting shorter every year. And I suppose that'll happen to me too. And so I'm not judging him for that. I just want you to know that. I'm just stating facts. But I am concerned about that influence in his life. Well, this week in France, we had another terror attack right on the Champs-Élysées in Paris. A man shot a policeman. ISIS claimed responsibility. It's being investigated as a terrorist attack. And the usual thing was, it was not a lone wolf. It was a known wolf. The person was known to security services. He'd actually served time in prison for shooting a policeman. Two policemen. And injuring, even a left-wing magazine said he injured them severely. He was sentenced to 20 years, and he was let out, I don't know, after 7 or 8. And now, what's he doing? He's shooting a policeman again, right in the middle of the heart of Paris. The immediate call was, oh, the French elections are today, at least for the initial stage of who's going to be the new president. I don't know how they're going. I don't know if the polls have closed yet. I think France is, what, four? I don't know how many hours ahead of us. At least 3 hours ahead of us. But very important election. And if the top one gets enough, that person will be the president. But if it doesn't get 50%, there'll be a runoff. And the immediate call was, suspend the elections. Stop the elections. You know, we have to get everybody calmed down. And my point was, don't stop the elections. Have them now while all this stuff that the leaders in France have allowed to have happen over the last 20 or 30 years is fresh in everybody's mind. They want to sweep it under. That's why they want time. They want to sweep their under the rugs. The Wall Street Journal has a great journal there on the thing on the left, La Divorce, splitting the Eiffel Tower, industry downturn lifts Le Pen. She's the nationalist candidate. And so this is from The Economist, a chicken little, or doesn't want to watch, and with the French colors. Theresa May also called for elections in surprise elections in Britain this week. And the belief is that she should, because the Labour Party is just being destroyed by anti-Semitism charges, proof of anti-Semitism, direct proof of anti-Semitism, that the Labour Party is just going to collapse in this election, and she'll have a very solid majority. So that's coming up in June. Last Sunday, there was this election, and this video has no sound, by the way. This is a rally that took place about 2 weeks ago, yesterday, in Izmir, Turkey. Now, why would you know the name Izmir? Maybe you would know Izmir, and I'm sure I'm saying it wrong, Izmir, I-Z-M-I-R, Turkey. It's right on the coast. And you might know the biblical town that's associated with that area is called Smyrna, where one of the seven churches was located. So Erdogan went there, and he had this big rally in front of, you can see thousands and thousands of people. And he was getting ready for the change in constitution vote that took place last Sunday, in which he won. Now, here's what he said when he was in, I'll call it Smyrna because it's easier for me to say. The Turkish president has blasted crazy, this is a news report from Turkey, blasted crazy European leaders for allegedly opposing Turkey's upcoming referendum on expanding his powers. Erdogan said Ankara will reconsider its bid for membership in the EU and the European Union after holding the plebiscite, casting new doubts about Turkey's decades-long membership drive. You have seen what happened in Europe, Erdogan said. Why did they go crazy? Why did they go berserk? They saw this, what this system will bring to Turkey. Turkey is leaping, growing. This makes them go crazy. Erdogan said at a pro-government rally on the western province of Izmir on Sunday. Germany and the Netherlands have prevented Turkey's ministers from campaigning on their soils for a yes vote in the April 16 referendum. Erdogan said, Europe will pay for what it has done. God willing, the question of the European Union will again be on the table after April 16. Erdogan further said, the Turkish president also labeled Europe as a sick man using the jibe that 19th century European politicians and leaders used to describe the Ottoman Empire, the aging Ottoman Empire. They said a century ago that we were the sick man. Now they are the sick man. Europe is collapsing. And there's a lot to be said for that. So Erdogan took this famous, and nobody can know who said that the Ottoman Empire was the sick man of Europe or Asia Minor. Nobody can trace it back, but everybody says, well, this person said this person. The fact of the matter is, this is going around for 100 years. Turkey was referred to as the sick man of Europe. And now Turkey's turning the tables and saying, look at Europe, it's falling apart. And we're reuniting behind me, the new, call him Sultan Erdogan or Caliph Erdogan. He wants to establish an Islamic caliphate. There it is. I'm looking for my mouse pointer. So a lot of papers say he's effectively a dictator. In the foreign policy, there was an article about with reports of unfree and unfair referendum, Turkey isolates itself further internationally. I don't think so. Now look, Turkey's an interesting country. To many Arabs, Erdogan remains a model reformer. On the other hand, among Arabs, diverging views on Erdogan. He is a Sunni Muslim. Here's what one bystander said, looking at what's going on in the election. Berkat Alshamrani, who was visiting Istanbul from Saudi Arabia, said he realized Turkey was divided over Mr. Erdogan, but he shrugged off the debate. What we now know is that he is a good, fair, popular Muslim leader, he said. Caroline Glick has a great article, so I've got a couple things here. I think we'll be done in about 10 minutes. And if I do that, this update will be under an hour, and you will know that the apocalypse is much closer than you thought. So Turkey and Trump's unpredictability. Great article by Caroline in her column on Friday in the Jerusalem Post. And she talks about Erdogan, and she's concerned about, you know, Trump called up Erdogan to congratulate him on, at least these were the news reports, congratulated Erdogan on what he did. I don't think congratulations are in order. I'm troubled by this. This is, I think, a huge end-time move in terms of alignment of nations and bringing things about like the alignment of Ezekiel 38 and 39. And you have now a dictator, a Muslim dictator in charge of Turkey. If he lives, and even Erdogan this week said, hey, you know, look, I could die tomorrow. And but if he lives, he could be in power for 15 years and have pretty much unchecked absolute power. Since the coup last summer, last July, about 150 to 200,000 people have been fired from government or military jobs or education jobs, and tens of thousands have been imprisoned. So Caroline talks about this and she says, what does this all mean? Given that this means that Turkey is now effectively indistinguishable from Erdogan, the central question that people should answer before determining whether they are pleased or displeased by the results of Sunday's referendum is, who is Erdogan and what does he want? Erdogan would say that he is a Muslim, but he has made very clear repeatedly that he sees no distinction between moderate Islam and radical Islam. Islam is Islam, he says. Maybe he is right, but in the West, distinctions are made. So it is important to set out what Erdogan means by Islam. And George Friedman has a thing where he says, now this is a little different perspective. You know, we usually look at Turkey going east to west. Now this is Turkey rotated, so that really what you have is Istanbul is almost there at the center, the pivot point. And so what Erdogan looks at, when he sees Turkey, this is what he sees. He sees all of this, the rest of this world, Northern Africa, the Middle East, and Europe, Eastern Europe, and the Balkans, even all the way up to the Lithuania, Latvia, and Estonia, sort of revolving around Istanbul. He's at the center, and this is the way he views the world. The very clever thing that George Friedman did with this map. And Caroline goes on to talk about it. As George Friedman wrote at Real Clear World earlier this week, for Erdogan, Islam is an all-encompassing worldview. Its precepts dictate human behavior on every level, and it rejects secularism. In Erdogan's Islam, the secularists believe that there is a distinction between the private and public spheres and that religion as a private matter is inconceivable. Erdogan's view is the reason that for nearly a century, Islam, as Erdogan views it, was banned from public life in Turkey. As Friedman explained, when Atatürk founded modern Turkey after World War I on the ruins of the Ottoman Empire and its caliphate, he recognized that he couldn't change the way that his people viewed the world. Rather than reform Islam, Atatürk repressed it. The secular democratic regime he created rested on the coercive power of the military, not on the consent of the governed. And what he did was he had secularists running the military, even though there were some Islamic people within it. And so when they introduce on the left here, you see them introducing this referendum that was just voted on last Sunday. And when it was introduced to change the Constitution, they got a bit lively in the debate. It got a little bit physical. Now, Erdogan is interesting. This is an article from 1999 where Erdogan went to prison. He went to prison for that speech that he gave in Turkey at the time he was the mayor of Istanbul. And what he did was he read a poem by nationalist ideologist Ziya Gökalp, in which he said, quote, "Our minarets are our bayonets, our domes are our helmets, our mosques are our barracks, we will put a final end to ethnic segregation, and no one," I'm having a terrible time with my mouse here today, "and no one can ever intimidate us. If the skies and the ground were to open against us, if floods and volcanoes were to burst, we will not turn from our mission. My reference is Islam." And he said there in another speech, there's no such thing as moderate Islam. Now, he was sent to prison for 4 months for that. What this article tells you from the one of the local daily newspapers in Turkey, which I think has been shut down now, or I'm not sure if this one's been shut down. He shut down a lot of the major newspapers. But this one said when he went to prison for 4 months, the motorcade that took him to prison was 2,000 cars long. He was banned for life from holding office in Turkey. And what happened was he and some others, when he got out of prison, they formed the AKP party. He campaigned, he led a campaign for the parliament. AKP took the majority of the parliament. I think this was around 2001. And then one of the things they had to do was the parliament had to vote on whether Erdogan could come into public service. And they overturned the ban for life that he had. And in March 2003, he became the prime minister. And he served in that office for 12 years. Then he was elected to be the president. And he wanted to be more than the president, because the president had limited power, so he's changed things. Over the last 12 years, what he's done is he's stripped people out of the military, and he's been very clever in the way he has gone about building what I would call Muslim Brotherhood Sunni-style dictatorship caliphate. He got rid of people in the military. He did his final purge. Whether he did the coup last summer or not as kind of a fake, I personally don't think he did that, because he's put so many people in prison, he actually hurt himself in some respects by gutting the leadership. But now he's cleaned house. And Caroline goes on. Erdogan was arrested, tried and convicted of inciting religious hatred. I already told you about that. All he did was read a poem, after all. That's what people in the West said. Why are you guys beating up on this poor mayor of Istanbul? He just read a poem. Due in part to the West's response there at the bottom to his arrest and conviction, Erdogan has used the U.S. and Europe as allies in his bid to win and consolidate power. And the interesting thing that Erdogan did was Erdogan's not a Western politician. He's an Islamic leader. And so he doesn't look at things like what's going to happen with the opinion polls that come out on Friday. What's the employment report going to be due on Friday? He is looking long term. He is looking beyond the time that even he would not be alive, because he's setting up Islam as a supreme power. The Bush administration's belief that liberal democracy is the default aspiration of humanity informed Bush's demand that Egypt allow Muslim Brotherhood candidates to participate in the 2005 parliamentary elections, and that Israel permit Hamas to participate in the 2006 Palestinian elections. This is Caroline's nice way of saying is the Bush administration, they were idiots. They didn't understand what they were dealing with. They thought that democracy would be great and all this, and they were wrong. The view also informed the administration's decision not to interfere in the Iraqi elections in 2005. The Bush administration devoutly retained its faith in the universal attraction of liberal democracy even after the Muslim Brotherhood scored extraordinary victories in Egypt, after Hamas won the Palestinian elections, and after the Iraqi government, whose leaders were supported by Iran, began colluding with Tehran. Bush and his advisors insisted that Hamas would become domesticated once it was forced to contend with constituents demanding that their potholes be filled. If we understood better how Trump feels about the totalitarian Islam that Erdogan adheres to, we would know better what to make of Trump's repeated statements of support for the Turkish leader. Does Trump realize the more powerful Erdogan has become, the less concerned he has become about how the West perceives him? Does Trump recognize that in recent years, Turkey has turned its back on Europe and become a major state sponsor of terrorism? Turkey is Hamas's most outspoken supporter. Until recently, Turkey served as Islamic State's mobilization center for foreign recruits and its logistical base. ISIS oil exports went through Turkey. ISIS forces received the medical treatment in Turkey. And Turkey became Iran's conduit to the global economy while it was subjected to UN sanctions for its nuclear program. Does Trump realize that Turkey opposes the U.S.'s most support for the Kurds, the most effective fighting force in the war against ISIS? Does Trump realize that to secure his victory and the referendum, Erdogan has repressed his opponents? And I think those are all good questions. I encourage you to go and read the full article at the Jerusalem Post from Friday, April 21st. Great column. I have to cover a couple. There goes the hour thing. So it's not the apocalypse yet, so just calm down. Barghouti, we actually got a late start today. Barghouti is a convicted murderer, nothing more. Here's what happened. The New York, as Mark Levin calls them, the New York Slimes posted an editorial by Marwan Barghouti. He is a terrorist. He was convicted of 5 murders. He was sentenced to life in prison. They published this, we're going to have a hunger strike in Israeli prisons. Now, it's kind of a fake hunger strike because I think they're not going to eat Israeli food, but they're allowed to have food brought in from other people. So it'll be interesting to see how many of them gain weight during the hunger strike. Remember when Al Sharpton and Jesse Jackson did this hunger strike? One would fast during the day, and then it was like a tag team, like a relay, and they'd pass, like, so Jesse Jackson and Al Sharpton, neither one of them lost an ounce during a really long fast that they had to protest something. But this was published, and the usual editorial in the New York Times is 600 to 700 words. This one was about 1,400. In the International New York Times, it was a whole half-page editorial, a manifesto from this terrorist. Now, the New York Times is interesting the way they describe Barghouti. He is a terrorist. He is a convicted murderer. He is not anyone that should be published and praised in the New York Times. So this is the edit. They decided that, well, maybe this was a little controversial, so we'll add an explanatory note to the end of this editorial, and here's what it said. Editor's note. This article explained the writer's prison sentence, but neglected to provide sufficient context by stating the offenses of which he was convicted. What they had described him was as a political leader and a parliamentarian in Palestine. Really got to the heart of what the guy's about there. They continued. They were five counts of murder and membership in a terrorist organization. Mr. Margudi declined to offer a defense at his trial and failed to recognize the Israeli court's jurisdiction and legitimacy. Now, on Thursday, Hugh Hewitt interviewed Michael Oren, who used to be the ambassador to the United States. You remember him? He went, I played video of him when he went to Cal State Irvine, University of California at Irvine, and the Muslim Student Association got up and interrupted his speech while he was trying to talk. And you remember there was I think he was the chancellor of the University of California at Irvine. So now just please calm down, please, you know, let's all get along and let's be nice. That man, by the way, is now the president of the Ohio State University. Just so you know, I had concerns when he came. So here's Michael Oren. Now, Michael Oren says, you know, this is crazy for the New York Times to do this. And listen to what he talks about his encounter with the New York Times a few years before.
May of 2010 with the New York Times, when Mahmoud Abbas published an op-ed in the New York Times in which he alleged that he insinuated that the Arabs accepted the UN partition resolution of 1947 and the Jews rejected it. And you know, I called up the editor of the New York Times and I said, wait a minute, this is exactly the opposite. Don't you check facts? We accepted it. The Arabs rejected it and went to war against it. That was the War of Independence. The Arabs rejected the first two-state solution. And he says, well, that's your interpretation. I said, wait a minute, there are certain, you know, incontrovertible historical facts, uncontestable facts. I mean, did the Allies land or did they not land on Normandy Beach in June 1944? And the editor's response was, well, some people think so.
And so that's a perfect example. So you might look that up on Hugh Hewitt's website. I have a couple things I want to do. Because I want to tie in the update. I called this the Super Mighty Update. And this is what North Korea threatened this week. There would be a Super Mighty Preemptive Strike reducing the U.S. military to ashes. And we know that on the North Korean border, China's put a bunch of troops, Russia's put a bunch of troops on its common border with North Korea. Nobody knows exactly what's going to happen. It's problematic because it's such a closed society, you don't really know whether he's got anything or whether he's just bluffing. And he only has to be right, or he only has to get it right one time and launch a missile that lands in California or Oregon or someplace. And you don't want to be the president when that happens. So it's a very difficult position for President Trump. Pray that he has wisdom on how to deal with this and other people in the world, because you know, Japan is in the same boat, and I think even China sort of sees the craziness of the threat. Now, I have a five-minute clip from Hannity with Benjamin Netanyahu. Do you want to watch it or not? Okay. So, it is because of you that I did not get done. This is not my fault. I'm being pressured. I feel a lot of pressure. You have no idea how much pressure I feel up here. But Hannity was in Israel. There's a 42-minute special from the other night. I would recommend that you get it and watch it. He does a good site. So it's a little bit of context and then a little bit of it, part of a very long interview with Benjamin Netanyahu. So let's play this and we'll finish with this.
Effectively, we are on the tri-state border, meaning we are literally between Israel, Jordan, and Syria. The villages around us here are all controlled by the Islamic State affiliate, and we see them frequently on this hill. We see them training, acrobatics, running, and we've even heard them firing, shooting, target practice.
Sort of right up in this
here. around 40,000, 50,000 Syrian residents that live in that area, with about 1,000 Islamic State operatives that manages the area. Just a few months ago, we had ISIS affiliates target an IDF patrol that were operating not far from here. They targeted them, they actually missed, and in our response, we killed four of their operatives, took out their position. They had actually set up their position in an abandoned United Nations facility, so that is now no longer poses a threat. And we sent a clear message: if you mess with us, you're going to pay dearly. And this is just one parcel, the Islamic State, which is one problem. Going further north, you have other forces linked to Al-Qaeda. And going further north, even to where the Hermon is, we have Hezbollah. So everywhere we look east from the border between Israel and Syria, we see negativity on the other side.
And welcome back to Hannity. So earlier this week, an IDF spokesman gave our Hannity producers a tour of Israel's northern border with Syria. Today, I asked Prime Minister Netanyahu about how his country has been impacted by the instability in the region and much more. Watch this.
It's interesting because we see the saber rattling of Kim Jong-un in North Korea and the threat that he made, again, a super mighty preemptive strike he's talking about against the United States of America. But, and this perhaps should be factored into when we talk about Iran, and that is that North Korea has nuclear weapons. Now, they would like ICBM capability, marry those nuclear weapons, then they'd have the capability of reaching the continental United States. I guess my question is, if you have a nuclear-armed Iran, how do you stop, how does the United States militarily stop him, Kim Jong-un, from getting ICBM capability when we know he has the capability of launching nuclear weapons at Japan, China, South Korea? How do you stop that at that point? It's too late.
Let me talk about Iran. I think it's immensely dangerous to have a regime which is not merely a rogue regime, but one here, in this case of Iran, which is, I think Henry Kissinger put it best, he said, it's a cause, it's not a country, Iran. What is the cause?
Caliphate.
The cause is to dominate first the Middle East and then the world with a Shiite revivalism, and to subjugate or remove anybody that stands in their way, first in the Muslim world and then anybody else.
Convert, die.
Or
die.
Yeah. Okay, now you'd say, well, that's madness. It can't be that in the beginning of the 21st century, you know, there are still regimes and movements, causes, that believe in this madness. Is it really? Cannot be? Of course it can. It is. It's right before our eyes. And what you see in ISIS is small compared to what you could see with Iran. They too have a cause. They think we're the ones who should be dominant. Mm-hmm. You know, the world should be an Islamist hill, and we're going to be king of the hill. And that's what they're fighting with the Iranian Shiites. Who's going to be king of this Islamist hill? But they don't disagree that it only has room for those who adopt and accept through submission their version of Islam. So who are there? Who's resisting it? First of all, other Muslims, they don't want to go down this path. And of course, non-Muslims like us, we don't want to go down that path either. So we've made common cause to stop these people. But the question right now is, what will happen in this battle if an Islamist state, an Islamist terrorist state, which is what Iran is, the preeminent terrorist state of our time, has the weapons of mass terror, nuclear weapons? You can imagine that this mad scheme, this mad ideology, will have the powers of to intimidate the world and do irreparable damage. We cannot allow that to happen. In the case of Iran, clearly it hasn't yet happened. And if we are resolute in our policies, very firm in our policies, we can make sure it doesn't happen.
And go look at the whole 41-minute program. It's very good. You can find it on the Fox News website. It's real, folks. This was a parade of military equipment. Okay, so North Korea did it last week, and they have some new intercontinental ballistic missiles, it appears. We don't know how they've done on new miniaturizing nuclear technology to make a bomb that they can put on a missile. And now they say we're going to do a super mighty preemptive update. And you can't dismiss the connection between North Korea and Iran and the sharing of technology. They're working together. We know everybody says, oh, Assad is this wonderful person. Do you remember 10 years ago? Assad had a nuclear reactor built in the area that's now possessed by the way, by ISIS. They would have control of this if that thing had stayed. And 10 years ago, the IDF went in, sent two jets, and they bombed it and they completely destroyed the thing in a massive explosion. They did the same thing, the IDF, the Israeli Air Force, I mean, stepped in and took out the Osirik reactor that Saddam Hussein had built. And now we have, and so Syria was aligned with North Korea, Iran was aligned with North Korea, Iraq was aligned with North Korea. Remember George Bush, even George Bush got it right occasionally, the axis of evil that he talked about. But here in Tehran, they're in front of Ayatollah Khomeini, the supreme leader of Iran, is a missile. And if you look down here at the bottom, you see the fists, you see the Israeli Star of David, and that says, essentially, death to Israel. Now, do you think that they're just joking about what they want to do? Listen, the Bible has told us for thousands of years that in the end time, these countries would be aligned against a revived Jewish state in the land of Israel, the homeland. You remember Stephen in the Sanhedrin reminding the leaders of Israel at that time? Do you know what God did, that this was the land of promise, that God brought everybody back? And so for thousands of years, the prophets have said, and we've had it, they're going to come back into the land in unbelief. That's Ezekiel 35 and 36. There'll be a country someone will make. There'll be a covenant made with them. There'll be all these things that happen. And all these countries around them will be aligned against them, and a coalition of countries will actually attack them. I'm telling you, I don't think this has ever been more brought into focus than has over the last couple of years. And each week, it just seems like it gets ratcheted up, turned up just a bit. So, my advice, pay attention, get your heart right, share the gospel with other people. Because they may not have much time. And we need to remember that. So let's pray. Father, thanks so much for your word. Thanks for your warnings. And Lord, I just pray that you would empower us by your Holy Spirit to go out here from here today and do what we should do, to do what the early apostles did, and share the gospel with a world that desperately needs it in so many ways. Bless us this week. In Jesus' name, amen.